show on Indian television where you, the MSME, get center stage. This is ET Now's special daily initiative to give MSMEs and entrepreneurs the opportunity to be front and center on every industry and area that matters to you. Tonight, we're bringing you the second part of a panel discussion that we did in Mumbai as part of a 20-city roadshow. These are the highlights for panel on I for Innovate, Innovation and Disruption for MSMEs. Take a look. We started this panel talking about finance, of course. Two divergent views coming from this side and this side. I want to take the opportunity now to, in fact, ask Mr. Vaidyanathan a question as far as finance is concerned. You see thousands upon thousands of applications at Capital First, all from entrepreneurs, everyone having a unique business idea. I want to hear from you, how do you decide that one person, you know, has what it takes, for instance? How do you decide this person has a marketable idea? Your own experience of what it has been like funding businesses.
First of all, this business of financing small entrepreneurs, apart from adding a social value to the system, is also an extremely good business. We find that NPAs among SMEs are much lesser. They are much more stable repayers and very bankable sort of people. And since they're generally underserved, they value an entity or a person who gives them some funding. It builds long-term relationship. Now, how do we choose good from the, not so good? Now, people traditionally tended to evaluate companies on the basis of income tax returns. Now, only all of us know about 3%, 4% of India pays income tax returns. So if income tax return was the basis of giving loan, then obviously you can give income tax loans to only 3% of the Indian people, which is one of the reasons why financing is so low. The really good news, I think, of late for the last 3 or 4 years, and that's not just Capital First, the whole ecosystem is evolving around giving loans to entrepreneurs on the basis of their own estimates of what we can evaluate their cash flow is, and not on the basis of their income tax return. I'll give you one example. There are a customer may have an income tax return of annual tax paid of only, show an income of only 2 lakh rupees. But you see the customer's bank balance on the important dates, the customer may have balance of even 2 lakh rupees. Therefore, if you don't look at the income tax return, but look at the customer's bank balance, you can lend them a lot of money.
All right, that's interesting, and thank you for that. Let me talk about what is happening in innovation as far as digital business are concerned. I do know the entrepreneurs here today, for instance, have moved beyond just digital businesses. But correct me if I'm wrong, and I want to open this up to the entire panel because I'm sure there are going to be different viewpoints. Most innovation today seems to be restricted, at least in India, as far as digital business are concerned, as far as what's happening in the online space. How does a country like India, which clearly needs innovation beyond just what's happening in the digital arena, ensure that innovation is happening in these areas? How do we have for example, more smart shifts? How do we have more green souls? How do we have more, CleanMax solars? How do we have more companies like SportzConsult? How does that happen?
Thanks, Sunanda. And this is something that I think all of us trying to start brick and mortar businesses have always felt, that why is only Snapdeal, Flipkart, why are these the companies? And I think the big reason there is the way venture capital seems to work in India, which is largely Silicon Valley firms or Silicon Valley inspired firms chasing models they understand in the digital space and trying to replicate them here. Which is why a solar company or a company that deals with logistics isn't well understood by capital, doesn't seem like a 2-year, 3-year story, and therefore not good enough for investors. And on the flip side, there's also the sense that the same venture capital may be ruining even the digital innovation at times by being too aggressive, by wanting to show returns and supporting business models that aren't tested in India and not necessarily context specific. So I think a lot of it comes from where the money is, and if the money is chasing only certain business models, that's got to change first. That's what will help entrepreneurs in other spaces really thrive and start business.
Just to add to that, we have this notion of innovation being something really big, digital, Facebook, Google. It need not be. It could be very small, especially in let's take in case of sports in India. We are finding that there is innovation where, they are solving a small problem of kids wanting to play. And we have a ground on top of a mall. If space is a constraint, there is some entrepreneur who has thought of putting a ground on the mall. and that's solving a problem. So there are small problems, might not necessarily be online, which are also innovative solutions.
No criticism to phenomenally successful digital companies, right? Taking nothing away from Flipkart and what they've done for this country. They've put ourselves on the global map in many ways. But, when I talk to venture capitalists and I'm telling them that my business is in logistics, I'm a B2B business, I'm trying to serve small and medium enterprises through small and medium enterprises, and they keep looking at me and they say, when's the hockey stick going to happen? When's the growth going to go 500%? When is this asset suddenly going to unlock value for millions? When are you going to reach this 1.4 billion people? And my reaction is, my business is not consumer internet. I am not here to touch the lives of 1.4 billion consumers. My business is to touch the life of 32 million SMEs and 50 million truck owners. It's very difficult when the same yardstick that's being used for a consumer internet company starts getting used for a company that's not in that space. And like he mentioned, Sushant mentions, that's where the money seems to be, because this 1.4 billion Indians is like a big attraction across the world. And that consumerism is something that people relate to and people want to invest in. Very few investors are interested in the space of B2B or hardcore manufacturing. Recently, I was in a tech event, one of the largest in Asia. I was hard-pressed to find any hardware and any manufacturing businesses in the fair. They were all fintech or digital payments or consumer internet, fashion discovery apps. Everything was an app. And no one understood B2B. So yes, it's the ecosystem, but I think it will change. Because what's relevant in the US may not necessarily be relevant in India, and that will change.
Let me throw some light on the innovation, what you're talking about, particularly when you said only the fintech and marketing and e-commerce. You know, how many SMEs we are looking at, not only particularly manufacturing, you take a retail. Mr. Vaidyanathan said, large company affected, medium size affected, smaller size affected. SME is not transforming their websites earlier. Now, last 4 years, you are seeing a lot of SMEs started presenting quality website, brochure, catalog. Company started branding their product and services. This is some transformation in their activity. But taking up the minister's statement, the IIT students can display innovative ideas or particularly prototype ideas. But what about the next? Is there this idea is converting into the business, profitable business? Which agency supporting? I know a lot of startups, they are doing a lot of best things. But how many entrepreneurs in a rural area facing big problem, not getting funding, not getting handholding, not getting support from the government, not getting particular market for the product? What is our idea to make the leaders tomorrow's leaders? We have to focus particularly the rural entrepreneurs. How we can give handholding, funding, knowledge, and support? Then only it is possible.
Time for a quick break here on Leaders of Tomorrow, but we'll continue bringing you the highlights of a panel discussion on innovation we did in Mumbai. Just stay tuned. Welcome back with us here on Leaders of Tomorrow. And tonight we're bringing you highlights of a panel discussion that I did on the theme of innovation. It had some of the biggest experts from their industries talking about how innovation for MSMEs is so critical. Do take a look.
I think first and foremost, when we talk about entrepreneurs, or small businesses or startups, they're not all one and the same. You have types of entrepreneurs, you have startups. Typically speaking, startups are really the high growth kind of, young companies, right? And therefore, there is the ecosystem that works around that. VC ecosystem being one of those, right? I think there's also a need to differentiate, what's your business type? And therefore, what's the right, ecosystem support for you? What's the right funding mechanism for you? I think if we don't discriminate between these things and we just end up going to an angel funder or a VC funder simply because that's the most visible money available, but you are the wrong kind of company, you know, you're going to face roadblocks. That's absolutely, you know, going to be the case, right? And the, on the other side, I think, you know, one of the big problems that we are seeing, and we are working with SMEs, what one terms typically as an SME, and we are seeing that even companies, you know, the revenue, annual revenues going up to 5 and sometimes even 10 crores are not even actively using simple digital tools. So it's not about, you know, just being a digital business. It's about, you know, understanding that enabling your business with the core digital tools is a requirement today. It doesn't convert your business into a digital business. But if you don't do it, how much are you leaving on the side? How much can you not access? Sure. I think those are important questions to ask.
Okay. I have, you know, just to take that point further, I have a question for you. And again, I'm opening this up for the entire panel. Like the government tried and is trying in the aviation market, for instance, encouraging more flights to the Northeast to ensure that that part of India is served. Should the government be encouraging those innovators and those ideators who are doing something necessarily for the grassroots levels? Or should innovation be left open to wherever the ideas are coming from, whatever market is being served?
I think in India we are very fortunate that there's been a very strong focus on social innovation. You know, we have a very good ecosystem. In fact, we are exporting this ecosystem to the rest of the world, Africa, rest of, you know, Asia and so on. Impact investment, we have a good category of, you know, impact investors out here. So I think, you know, the market has basically responded to the need for social innovation in India, and that ecosystem exists. Now, does that mean that the government shouldn't, you know, focus on it? I'm not saying that. I think, you know, we have a very large country. There's a lot of lead and there are a lot of, you know, social innovators. And so any additional support is absolutely, absolutely necessary.
Shriyans, I want you to respond to that because you are in the field of social innovation in some sense. Would you agree that, yes, it should be opened up?
Yeah, I think it started with fintech, but soon moving to other industries as well. And what I think in terms of social enterprises is that they first have to get the basics right, which is how to make the business profitable and sustainable. We see a lot of NGOs around social causes. But how to get a product, how to get corporate CSR, how to do it as a service, I think those things are very important. And in terms of funding, it could come not just from investors, it could also come from your vendors. Like, suppose we recycle for Adidas and Zara today, so they're ready to fund us. So it could come from innovative ways, support could come from the government as well then.
Since we're talking about innovation specific to India, innovation which is more grassroots led, I want to talk about how closely Indian innovators, the Indian market, the Indian ecosystem should be looking at what's happening globally.
I mean, knowledge is power, right? You always want to know what First Solar is doing in the US, so at the very least you can learn from their mistakes, learn from how they went from point A to B in 5 years and do that in 2 years. But I think a lot of us in India do stretch that a bit too far. We say, well, let's do exactly the same thing. Let's try and replicate a model that's been terribly successful. But for various reasons, that doesn't work in India. One is our business ecosystems aren't quite as streamlined, aren't quite as smooth as many in the West. So when I set up a business in India, there's a lot of maneuvering to be done to get it from point A to point B. So I think it's great to know and great to learn, but you shouldn't be replicating it. I think a lot of people have failed to recognize that so far. With all due respect, everyone.
I just realized a lot of people, what we do is we like cut, copy, paste, and we imitate. It's nice to imitate the business model if the need was real. So if there is a need in New York, Manhattan to get taxis, does that need exist in the same form and nature in India? And then it would make sense for you to cut, copy, paste, because you're actually replicating a model that serves a need. Having said that, I think a lot of times we tend to get carried away with the success of very big models globally and say we should try that in India without understanding the quantum of the need, how big that need is, how relevant it is. And like Sunita mentioned, sometimes you forget what ecosystem you are playing with vis-a-vis what those entrepreneurs are playing with. So I think knowledge is always power. You cannot cocoon yourself and say, you know, I'm only going to look at India. You need to know what's happening to the world. We're all global citizens now. having said that, be true to what is your market, your consumer's actual need, and then decide how you want to take a business model which is successful and adapt it to your space.
Yeah, one thing that I would like us to learn is ability to deal with failure. I think even in schools and even in organizations, we find that, you know, failure is some taboo, and we look them upon in a very, in a downgraded manner. I think in the West, especially if an entrepreneur has failed, I think he is looked upon as someone, you know, who can do better next time. As opposed to here, we almost condemn the failure. I mean, that's something which we could learn from our global group counterparts.
Let me at this point open it up for any questions from the audience.
I want to develop my business. So how government help to me to explore my business?
See, friends, you know, when you start a business, the business plan should be prepared. You should have your business plan, marketing plan, branding plan, how to go for funding plan. So when entrepreneurs will start adopting all the business ethics, particular system, then only you can achieve your target.
My question to this panel here is, tell me something, what is the level of skill development done in this country after Modi Sarkar has taken over?
You know, 5-6 years ago when we started CleanMax Solar, one thing which we found was that once you actually won projects and created the business model, financed it, there weren't too many people who could put up those solar plants, right? People, just technicians who didn't know how you put together the panels, the inverters, whatever's needed to run what is otherwise not terribly complicated technology. 6 years in, and I don't know how much of that is Modi Sarkar or just the evolution of an industry in the country, that has changed dramatically. I also know it's part of the curriculum, the various ITIs to run solar plants, DC electrical technology, which was never studied earlier, is now very much. So things are changing, whether it's terribly fast, whether it's innovative, whether it's because of government, it's hard to say.
It brings me to two questions. One is, who are the entrepreneurs of tomorrow, who are the leaders of tomorrow? And the next one is, how are the leaders of tomorrow? And we keep coming to the point of leaders or entrepreneurs not getting funding. But I think what's also equally important is the value system that doesn't simply stop at funding. We have entrepreneurs who are willing to go as down to bootstrapping to start their ventures. And my question is to the entrepreneurs who are here, on as opposed to having Jugadu entrepreneurs who simply try and start something, to having an ecosystem where we learn how to have a structured business. Did you face any kind of difficulty? Because, you know, we grew up in India and probably not seen much of structured businesses evolving. Did you have to face any kind of hurdles in trying to set your business in a good way?
You mentioned a very important point, that this is not requirement of capital, but also of quality startups. So I think that is another area which is really picking up in not just fintech, but spreading to other industries as well. And just adding briefly, what leaders of tomorrow, as for me, is, it's where the puck is going to be, not where it already is.
As the evening wore down, Dr. Hiru Bijlani, Master Licensee at Leadership Management India International, also addressed the assembled MSMEs on the theme of entrepreneurship.
I was a resource person at a young leaders conference in China a few years ago. And what I'm going to talk about is, what are the key things that young leaders need to know to be successful leaders in their fields? The first thing that emerged at this conference was to know that leadership is an art and a science. Now, that sounds like a cliche, but it is not. A lot of research shows that the art of leadership is using the creative side of your brain, and the science is using the rational side of your brain. And leaders need to know right from the beginning, and this is for young leaders who are in the age of 18 to 40, that they need to be aware that they need to be rational and creative in their thinking and emotional. So that was point number one. Point number two is that young leaders need to have not just a goals and vision and mission, as was mentioned by Mrs. Salunke, but they also need to have passion.
that concludes part two of the highlights of a panel discussion we did in Mumbai on innovation. If you have any feedback for us, do remember you can always write in at leadersoftomorrowtimesgroup.com or on social media. Tweet at us at Sunanda_J or LOT_ET now. On Facebook, we're at leadersoftomorrow@ET now. You can also call us on that number you see on your screen. We love hearing from you. Thanks very much for watching. Have a good night.